So as you guys can see from Rudy's background, we're doing another webinar series starting next week called Dismiss the Myths. It's going to be six mini sessions, all about 30 minutes to 40 minutes, just going through some of the commonly held beliefs of Jakarta that we don't think are true. And Steve's going to be shedding some light on them. Cool. All right. So today, guys, as we regularly do, this is going to be about the June release, giving an overview of what's new, what's different. Rudy's also going to be talking about communication protocols as well as our extra feature. On the agenda is the community release, obviously the autoscale extension, logging improvements as well with the enterprise release, Metro, JAX-WS implementation, HSTS support, and the Pair Kubernetes operator as well. If you guys have any questions, please just pop them on the chat or in the Q&A section. I'll make sure I get to them and I'll either put my nose in when there's a break or I'll ask it towards the end. We might have some polls as well, so just keep your eyes open for that. Over to you, Rudy.
Okay. Thank you, Jaden. Start sharing my screen. So indeed, it is the June meetup about the release, but also May, because we do it now every 2 months, we group them. And as an addition, I'll talk a bit about communication protocols and gRPC, because we get more and more questions about it. And so I can give some background and what we are doing around that also. So the community release, in May, we released the 2021.3. There were a few notable changes. One of them is the Hazelcast 4.2 that we added. And so it was already 4.1. And that was in relation to something else that we are working on, which is called tenant control. So that when you put objects in the Payara domain data grid, which are CDI beans, that if you retrieve them again from the grid, that the necessary injections are done so that you have a fully functional CDI bean again. We are also extending that tenant control to classes loaded from the through the service loader mechanism. So that means that we are greatly expanding the capabilities of the usage of CDI and EGB within the Payara products. It is not entirely stable in the sense that you can have some issues when using the domain data grid in some configurations. Putting values in the grids can result in error messages. We have a flag to disable them for the moment, but when it is stable, I assume in the next release, then we are looking to port that also to enterprise, of course. Another important aspect of that May release is, of course, that we have fixed a remote code vulnerability related to the Metro framework. So if you are having an application that is using SOAP messages, so you have SOAP endpoints, then make sure that you update to this May or June release, because once those applications are deployed, there is a possibility with specially crafted SOAP message that you can initiate a remote code execution on the server. So that's, of course, something which is important and to mention, and that you should upgrade to this latest versions. Another security related one is the HTTP security transport header. More on that later. I have an example. I'll explain what it is for those who are not familiar with it. So it is important. In some cases, and now you can do it by configuration, and you don't need to create a servlet filter yourself in your application to have that kind of functionality. the release last week contained something where we're a bit proud of. It's only partial implementation, of course, but it's the first realization of the bits and pieces of what we call the autoscale feature. And those who have followed the roadmap webinars of Steve, they probably know what it is, but I'll show you again what the idea behind that autoscale feature is. And I can give a demo what we have already available in this release. More to come in the following releases. So it will probably take another 3 or 4 releases until it is fully realized, because it is a very big feature with a lot of moving parts. What was also announced in that in those roadmap webinars was some logging improvements. So the first round is in now. So that means we have fixed a few issues, a few corner cases when the number formatting, for instance, was not correct. And we also updated the feature where you can use environment variables in the logging property files. So that is compatible with JDK 11 without any reflection usages, because we are slowly moving to also to make the codebase compilable on JDK 11. So in preparation to run on JDK 17, which is again an LTS version. So very important for us because we support all those LTS versions. So important for September. There are also already some tests done with Payara Micro on that JDK 17 early access build. So, and all of them are very looking very nice. So we are moving in those things. Moving on those fronts, but again, that's all background that will be visible in the following months. We have discovered just like something 10 days before the release that there was or there is still an issue if you try to run Payara server on the latest JDK versions, the JDK 8 update 192 or JDK 11 revision number 11, because they have disabled TLS 1.0 and 1.1. It seems that the JMX server, part of Payara server, is still using that TLS 1.1, and that means it does not start properly, and that some monitoring functionality is not available. But we have already fixed now for our enterprise users, and the community release there, we provide a fix with the next release at the end of next month. For all the information about what's in the release, you can have, as usual, a look on that Payara documentation site. So what is that HTTP strict transport security header? So if your client connects to the server, by default, most people just type in the host and the URL path, so they don't specify the HTTP in front. So that is taken by default. But now, of course, most of the servers are running with HTTPS. That means that the server sends a redirect back with, please use HTTPS, and the client does that, no problem. But of course, that initial HTTP, that's not secure. So any malicious person in the middle can track that and can send the redirect on behalf of the server, redirecting to another website that he's in control of and tries to steal as much as information, data, information around your identity and so on from you by manipulating that redirect. So either you should always use HTTPS, but no one is typing that. So there is then the solution of that's HTTP strict transport security header. That if the server sends that to the client knows that for future requests that always the HTTPS needs to be used also when the user types HTTP. So it is an overrule of what the user wants, because the client knows from previous communications with that server that it is expected to be in HTTPS. That's of course a bit better than, for instance, plugins who by default convert everything from HTTP to HTTPS, because there are still some sites who are using HTTP. So that's to cover the initial point where you can be vulnerable for those kind of attacks. As mentioned, you could do it before with the servlet filter, but now you can do it through configuration. So I have here a Payara environment that I can start. And when I then call just the homepage of the standard homepage of the Payara server through HTTPS, then you will see that the header just contains the normal information. Takes more time because I guess my laptop has a bit of problems with the heat in the room. So the cooling is not as good as it should be. So when I execute the curl command to the homepage of the server, localhost, the default 8181 port, insecure because it is a self-signed certificate by default, then you just get the information that at the contact type is text HTML and the length of the document, and by default it is HTTP2, so that's fine. But you can then of course you can change the configuration like this. You can set the HSTS enabled on that listener. So listener 2 is responsible for port 8181. So you can enable it. You need to restart the server. So that means that you should do it from the beginning. We cannot perform this dynamically for the moment. That's just something that we can look into if we can improve that. And once the server is up and running again, you can call that same that same page, that same index page, curl minus s. And then you see that the server replies with the header, the additional header, that strict transport security. And by default, the max age is 1 year. So the client is now instructed. Of course, curl does not keep track of it, but your browser keeps then track of this information, that for the next year on, if you type HTTP localhost, then he will always try to use HTTPS localhost, so overriding that information. So that will stop then the issue that you have even with HTTPS, that there is a small time frame, a small window where the malicious person can still do his work even if you are using HTTPS. Around that autoscale feature, this is a graphic that we showed you already during the roadmap webinar. So that's the entire feature. That's all the moving parts. And we have done now at the first bits of it. But the idea is that you have a deployment group at the clustering mechanism for Payara 5, where your application is running on multiple Payara instances at 3 or even more. And you need those kind of deployment group. You don't always need it. You only need it, for instance, for HTTP session replication for server-side frameworks like JSF. So that deployment group is there important, but you want to have, of course, some kind of auto-scaling, that the number of instances can grow depending on the size of the number of requests. What we have done now already, we have then created that compute API. So it is a ASAdmin command, but it's also a REST command if you want to create external tools that interact with it, so that you can just ask the deployment group of please add me another instance. by default, you can do it manually today, of course. You can say create instance, add instance to that deployment group, etc. So all those things are possible, but not just in an easy, simple scale up command to that deployment group what we have implemented today. And the API is already implemented for virtualization. So for if your environment uses SSH nodes, then it can search for the best location where another instance can be added, and it starts up there an additional instance, and so that requests can be routed to it. That's also a missing part today, that that ingress API, what's mentioned there, so it's the routing. So of course your load balancer need to know that there is an additional instance and that it can also handle those requests. That's also something which is planned for the future, the same as the ability to define all the rules and the metrics which determine how the deployment group will scale automatically. But the first parts are there, some of the groundwork is done. And even if it's maybe not 100% useful today as it is with SSH node, you can make even some scenario, some environment where it is, where it can be useful as you will see in the demo. So it is about automating the scaling of instances. So it's not that you need to execute ESAdmin commands. Currently, we have that command to automatically add a new instance, and it is balanced around the different SSH nodes. But mentioned the future plans is that we integrate it with some existing solutions like Azure Scale Sets and Kubernetes Replica Sets, so that based on those solutions, that if we get the information from Kubernetes, for instance, or Azure, that this, the set should grow, that we reflect that in the size of the deployment group with a additional instance. And as mentioned, the routing and the rules, they will also be addressed for a future version. It is an extension, so by default, it is not available within the download. So if you just download Payara community version, that feature is not available, and you need to add additional jar files, which are available on our Payara Nexus server, version 1.0. How you can do that and where you need to place them, that's all on the documentation on the website. So let's see how I can make it work here on my machine. And I'm going to use Docker, because you can use SSH nodes on Docker. So I can first start all the servers. So I start multiple servers. I start the Payara domain server itself, and I start some empty Docker images, empty Docker containers, where only an SSH node is available. Where I can SSH into it and install Payara. So if we look at what is started, and then we have, as mentioned, the domain server, and I have two Payara nodes where I start the SSH daemon. And to bypass the issue that we did not have already the routing integration, I'm using traffic as load balancer, which can automatically detect based on some labels that you put on containers, which can add the routing automatically to those containers. So this is now a bit due to the limitation that we do not have the routing implemented yet. The servers are started, so I can execute some command within the domain server to prepare my entire setup. And for that, I'm going to cheat a bit and copy paste, because And we don't want to make too many issues, too many errors in the commands. What does it do? You see the output. So it creates the deployment group. As we mentioned, you need a deployment group. He creates a new configuration, and that's a configuration based on the default configuration, which will be used for those new Payara instances on that deployment group. And those four options here, for instance, are all related to the memory management within containers. It is using the heap based on the size of the containers. And then the other commands that he does is creating those SSH nodes within Payara. So that means that the software is already installed on those two nodes here, which only had the SSH daemon. So that means that the software is now available, but still there is no application running. There is an application deployed, but it is deployed in a domain group which has no instances. So we cannot call our endpoint. So we need to do two things, because a deployment group does not know how to scale itself. So we need to add a what we call a scaling group, to that deployment group, and that's the name of the deployment group, which identifies if the deployment group needs to scale, by which configuration parameters it is done. So this is a scaling group based on those SSH nodes. As mentioned, we will create one for example, for the Azure scale sets. So we attach it to that deployment group we have. We specify that configuration that we have prepared for those instances that need to be created. And we identify that those two nodes which are available. So that's maybe that's something that I can show already through the is to the web console. That we have already those available. As you see, we have those nodes. We have the two nodes, Payara node 1 and 2, which are SSH nodes, which are available, and we can connect to it. But there are no instances running, and there is a deployment group which is empty, and an application which is prepared to be running on that deployment group, but there is no instance already. With this commands, I can create in that scale group. And once I have that scale group, I can just say scale up that deployment group. So this is the automation part. So it's still manually triggered, but then he looks for where is the best location where I put it. He randomly chooses now between node 1 and node 2 because they are equally used, meaning they are not used at all. So it just uses one of them, and he uses Payara node 2. So he created, he started a new instance. It gives always some cute names on it, a goldfish this time. And then the scale up was executed successfully. If you look then here on the deployment group, we can see that our goldfish is running and our application can be accessed. Traffic needs some time to do it, but yeah, it's already there. So you see it's executed on one of the two servers. That's this host name of the Docker. And I put something in that domain data grid. And first time, of course, the value is 0, but then I have increased it. And every time I get one higher value, of course, always executed from the same server. If I scale up now again, the system will add another instance, and he knows now that system two is a bit busy, it's working. So he will choose Payara node one, if everything goes well, of course. And the traffic will pick up that automatically and can route that those requests if needed to that other new Payara instance. It's again, it's correct. Payara node one, and now it is careful seek at the names. Again, if we look here, back to our deployment groups, we see now that there are two there, so everything is reflected as usual if you do it manually. And if you call it the first time, it is still the same server. But after a few times, you see the round robin is not 100% with the traffic, then you see that the other server is picking up this request, but you see he keeps, of course, as it should be, the value of the cache in the domain data grid. You have scale up, but of course you can do scale down, that's the same. And then he stops and the delete fails here now. So that's a nice one. Besides the scale up, you can also do, of course, the scale down. And the instance is stopped, but apparently the removal was not successful. So that's the idea of the auto scale. And now triggered by that scale up and scale down commands only for SSH node, but as mentioned, we will improve it, expand it, and then it will be, of course, much more useful to be using that kind of functionality within the Payara server. Any questions about this? Because this is a large chunk, and maybe someone has a question. Jaden, someone?
I don't see any yet. Checking the chat, then, checking the QA, nothing yet.
Then maybe we can pull up the first poll then.
Yeah,
because it's related to that auto scaling.
Sounds good. Okay, poll one.
So yeah, I'll describe how that scaling could work and what the idea is. So what do you think? Is it useful for your case? No, I don't need it for various reasons, because maybe you don't have those fluctuations. Or my application isn't designed for it, so that I can just scale up randomly or scale down randomly. That's also a possibility. Or no, I'm just interested in integrating external tools. Like as I mentioned, those Azure Scale Set. You can do it, of course, also without our auto scale. That's also an option. You like the idea that Payara is driving the scaling. It's so what we are trying to do with the auto scale feature. Okay, I think everyone had the chance to respond. Let's
see. Yeah, we have 85%.
Okay, so
cool.
Show us the results, Jaden.
Well, I'll bring them up. Share results.
So people indeed like the idea, and that one person, that application isn't designed for this kind of things. Well, probably it is, but maybe with a few modifications. So seems that everyone is liking this idea. So stay tuned then for the next months, because we will release, probably every release, something new around that autoscale feature.
Oh, we just had a question as well.
Okay.
From our friends from Dataverse. He said, we're using Payara with Dataverse. I have no clue if the app needs changes for autoscaling to work. Can/does Payara help with detecting issues?
It's more about your architectural setup, and if you have the ability to use caching or not, I don't think there are really some technical concerns. So even if your application is not doing anything with the domain data grid, then you still can deploy it like this, and you have multiple instances which can respond to the user requests. Of course, then you have more benefits if you can implement caching, and that the caching is distributed so that the work is a bit offloaded and can be reused. But as I said, most of the time, your application will just work in this kind of scaling, clustering technology without changes. But if they want to discuss more, you can always use the Payara forum to ask questions about it, and we monitor it so that we can ask more specific questions around this on that forum.
Yeah, I hope that helps, Chris. As Rui says, hit us up on the forum, and hopefully we can have a more detailed chat if there's other aspects of it that you're worried about.
Sure. We like to have feedback about this, so please.
Yeah, Dataverse is a good project as well, actually. I think it's really interesting.
Enterprise. We have the same, more or less the same thing, so I'm not going to specific demonstrate something about enterprise, because we also have that remote code vulnerability, which is fixed at the HSTS header, and those logging improvements and various bug fixes. And by default, we have that issue on the newest JDKs with the TLS removed, but there is a patch available for enterprise users if someone would be interested in running those latest versions of the Java. Then to the next topic, which is already mentioned 2 months ago, and that was at that point in preview, that we said that we are working on the Payara Kubernetes operator. So that's now also released. For those who didn't see the demo at that time, have a look at the recording from that meetup, because it's not that dramatic changed. So I'm not going to redo that demo again. I'm just going to explain it here a bit more in detail now, how it is working for those who are following this release webinar. And again, it is about scaling within that deployment group. So this Payara Kubernetes operator will probably be integrated later on with that autoscale feature, because it does exactly what we mentioned with that autoscale, namely scaling a deployment group, but within Kubernetes and running on Docker containers. So again, we have that Payara domain server. We have multiple instances in the deployment group, and you can set up that already today manually, and it requires some commands and some additional tweaks that you need to do, but it is possible. That's Payara operator that we have created must make it much more easy to do that. So you don't need to know how you need to set up those things. You just need to write that CRD document, which is mentioned there. That's the customer resource document. That's something Kubernetes specific. Our Payara operator picks it up, and based on the configuration that you specify in that CRD, it knows enough to spin up that domain server, that deployment group, and those Payara instances, and can do all the work that you normally do manually. It can do that for you, that operator. So how does that custom resource document look like? And yes, it is in YAML, of course, with Kubernetes. Sorry for those who hate YAML. So this is a typical document that you can use. You have within the specification and the configuration of the environment that you want to create within Kubernetes. You have that application image, which contains the Payara server then, and it also contains your application, which will be deployed later on. And then you have that image, what we call the instance image, which will be used for those Payara instances, which is based on that official server node image that we have. There is now still a small modification needed for this operator, but that will be integrated in the future within the default server node image. And then one of the configurations that you can say is I need two instances. So the Payara operator sees this and starts up a container, a Kubernetes deployment for that application image. Payara server starts up, and based on that, he says, oh, you need two instances. So he creates the deployment group. He creates the configuration. As I mentioned, you need a specific configuration for running in Docker with those for the heap, etc. So he does that all for you, creates it automatically. He also deploys that application there, what you mentioned, that should be there in the application image. Later on, we will allow for HTTP access so that you can download it, for instance, from a Nexus server. You also have that config script, the second to last option, where you can, for instance, configure your database connection. And then the last step that he does is based on that instance image, he creates another Kubernetes deployment set up with a replica set by default two, because you specify there two as a property. And he assigns the correct sizing. So that means here CPU 2000 means two virtual CPUs and 512 megabytes of memory. And all that just so that you do not need to put all those manual commands and get a deployment group working on the Kubernetes cluster. As mentioned, last time, 2 months ago, I did a video, a demo. So have a look at that if you want to see it in action. There should be a blog out today on how to use this one. And there is also some documentation on the website. So all that is available. And it is, as you see on the version, it is also a proof of concept. So it's an MVP, a minimal viable product. It's not final. There are several things that needs to be done. So feedback, again, is very appreciated for the use cases that you want to use it or the changes that you propose. Any question on the Kubernetes operator?
Nothing in the chat, nothing in the Q&A at the minute. But feel free to ask, guys.
At the end, we also have time, so we can come back to this if needed. So there is a lot in the pipeline. You see it, the releases, what's contained in the releases does not seem much, and it is true. We have less features and new functionality in the releases the last 2 to 3 months because there is a lot of going on in the background. One of the things is that we have now a Payara 6 version, the first version, Alpha 1, but we have a Jakarta EE91 certification. So we successfully run all the TCKs both on JDK 8 and JDK 11. So we are certifying for both JDK versions, which not everyone does. Also, the full server is the full profile is certified. More on that. If you have questions, if you should switch now to Payara 6 or why that Payara 6 could be useful today or only in the future. We are working on the MicroProfile 4.1 release also for enterprise. Enterprise is still working with 3.3. So we are upgrading enterprise to match the latest version, and MicroProfile 4.1 is released in 2 weeks or something. So we like to have it immediately available afterwards in both editions. We also spent some time for some customers around CRPC. So that's one of the topics which I will discuss also in a moment. And then of course, as mentioned, we are doing things around auto-scaling, logging, continuation on that on JDK 11 and JDK 17 support and all those kind of things. So there is a lot of things in the pipeline. So that means that the releases sometimes contain not that much new features and functionality. So the question around Spyara 5 and Spyara 6, because I assume that is a bit confusing for a lot of people. So I compare here Spyara 5 community, just for the sake, because I mentioned their micro profile, which is not available there in enterprise at 4.0, and that Spyara 6. So what are the differences? When should you use 5 and when you can try out Spyara 6 maybe? So if you're interested in running Jakarta EE9, and you know that with the new namespace, with the Jakarta namespace, so all the Java X, well, most of them, not all, like 90% of the Java X package names and names XML namespaces are changed for EE9. That is available in community. So you can create a Jakarta EE9 application. You can deploy that on Spyara 5 community and it will work because we have that transformer which transforms them back to Jakarta EE8 because the namespace is the only change. Why do we need Spyara 6? Well, just to be certified because the TCK, so the test compatibility kit to make the certification possible has some special checks in it. For instance, it checks that a certain exception, if that is thrown, that the complete package name is a certain package. And of course, for EE9, that package starts with Jakarta .servlet, etc., which of course on Spyara 5 it returns javax.servlet, etc. So that means that we cannot pass the certification on Spyara 5, although the functionality is identical, only the namespaces internal are different. So it is certified, so that's the main reason for Spyara 6, but Spyara 5 works as good as Spyara 6 for that for the Jakarta namespace. The same for Jakarta EE8, but or a Java EE8. There, Spyara 5 is the certified version. You can check that. And also, Spyara 6 can run Jakarta EE8 application. There, we do just the inverse. That Java X namespace is converted to Jakarta X to Jakarta namespace if you deploy the application. What we did not do yet is move the micro profile version to that Jakarta namespace for the simple reason there is no micro profile version for the moment. So micro profile is planning to have a release micro profile 5 in October, which uses that Jakarta namespace. So until that, we cannot produce Spyara 6, which has micro profile capabilities. Which means that Spyara 5 is, if you ask us, still the edition, the version that you need to use, and that Spyara 6 is only there for, sorry to say it, only for marketing reasons to get that certification. So that's why we also do not plan to have monthly releases for the moment, only for Spyara 5. But if you already want to play with Spyara 6, because in the following months we will doing changes for those who follow the roadmap webinar, changes like removing the weld and only relying on HK2 as a CDI engine and those kind of things. Those will be available in Spyara 6, so you can try it out. It is for someone who wants to live on the edge and give us feedback besides the testing that we do. Any questions on Spyara 5 versus 6?
Not at the minute. Nope.
Okay. A bit on the monthly theme then, the communication protocols. Because as I mentioned, we have some questions around gRPC. MicroProfile is also talking about having a specification around gRPC, how you can have it within Java, and especially then Java Enterprise. So this is a bit of an overview of all the protocols. So everything starts with that internet protocol, where TCP and UDP, so that's the asynchronous one. So there is no direct connection, and the TCP, there is a direct connection between the two parts, between the two parties. So that's the basis of everything, I guess, not everything in the world, but let's say like 80% or 85% of the things are, like everyone knows that TCP/IP protocols, as a lot is based on that kind of communication in the world. On top of TCP, although not always required, but most of the time you have that the classic HTTP, where you just send data between the client and the server. You can have then the TLS, the transport layer security, which adds the security, so the encryption. But also other protocols like FTP and LDAP and XMPP, so the messaging protocol. All those are based, or almost in all cases, based on TCP. So gRPC is then just a way of describing how data needs to be sent to be between client and server based on HTTP2. So it is not something which is different than, and so it does not belong to that application layer, which I, although that's not always correct, but the application layer there, gRPC is just a way of packaging the data compressed in a binary format using HTTP2 between the client and the server, adding streaming, because HTTP has the ability to multiplexing and streaming. So all that functionality you find also in gRPC, so that you can have a two-way simultaneous streaming communication between client and server. So we have gRPC under test for customers. So they can use it. Some of the customers are testing it out. And the idea is indeed that we make it available in Payara Enterprise. And you can ask yourself the question, why should I use gRPC? Well, it is efficient for a large set of data due to that compression, that binary, then it is more efficient. Also efficient when you have bi-directional streaming. So if you have continuous communication between client and server. And it has a stricter protocol. That protofile, which defines how the communication is done, is more strict than just the JSON, for instance, that you see with the REST protocol. But of course, the REST you have with the JAX-RS, for instance, with Java, the REST specification, you have a wider tooling, and you have the ability to caching. Also, the style is a bit different with REST. Everyone is saying REST is not a remote procedure call, so REST is about data and transferring data. Well, gRPC is, as the name says, a remote procedure call, but in a way that it can be used efficient at due to that binary compression thing that it uses. And in that sense, it is a bit like remote EGBs, so that's also a remote procedure call. So some people see it as a replacement for REST, but actually it is more a replacement for remote EGBs in the Java world. gRPCs are mainly, clients and servers are mainly developed in Go, but it's not restricted, of course, because as you saw, is based on HTTP2. So if you implement the correct way how those data frames, as they call it, are used within HTTP2, then you can use it in any language, also in Java, and also using the standard servlet technology, what we have done for. I thought I had another image, but apparently not. So I can show you How it works. Maybe first have a look at the code. So it still starts from that that proto file here, where, as I mentioned, where you define very specifically how the methods look like, how the data which are transferred, and you see a definition of each message type within between server and client is defined here. So all that information is still used there, but then based on a Maven plugin, we create a abstract class, that's the default proto buff Maven plugin. And then you have then this CDI bean. So it's based on that auto-generated class here, which implements or what you need to implement, and of course yourself, what the server needs to do when the client calls this get feature method as defined in that protobuf file. This example comes from one of the official examples from gRPC itself, from the Java gRPC. So the only thing that I changed there was that I use it as a CDI bean so that I can use some CDI features which are not available in standard Java gRPC. So I can use here, of course, not that useful, but I have some utility methods which are in a separate class, etc. But basically, I can do whatever I like here, what I can do in Java EE or in Jakarta EE. So we have combined two worlds, gRPC and Java Enterprise. I have here prepared a environment with it. So that's for our customers to test out. So I can have here the start domain. So it is an environment based on the latest enterprise, combined then with that all the gRPC dependencies.
Chris has a question.
Yes.
He asks, out of curiosity, where does AJP fit in this?
AJP is a kind of HTTP variation used in the Apache server to more efficient communication between the load balancer and, for instance, Payara server. Payara server also supports AGP. So instead of forwarding the request from the user as plain HTTP or HTTPS, then it is wrapped in a binary format and sent like that to the Payara server. And Payara server replies and also in the AGP format to the Apache's front end at the load balancer. So yes, that's a good question. I did not put it. Did not put that on the slide. So as I mentioned, the latest enterprise version. I deployed then just as any kind of application. I deployed the WAR file list. Applications is multiple because you can have multiple. I have I deployed that root guide, which is here created just as with any kind of web application, it is here deployed. You also have the ability to have the servers, the client generated, so the client classes, which I'm using then here. Again, this is from the standard one, which are the standard Java example, which is a bit modified for Payara. But you see that that client communicates with the server. This is the streaming one. You see that there was some information going on from a certain point, etc. So it is plain gRPC as communication, but on the client side and on the server side, you both have Java, and within Payara, you even have the full capabilities of Jakarta EE. So that's it. Any other question about gRPC or protocols?
Nothing currently, but they might take a second to type it up.
Okay, then maybe I'll do the announcement then. As Jaden said, we start next week with the Dismiss the Myths around Jakarta EE. So it's 6 weeks. You can register for one of them. Each topic is listed, or if you are interested in all of them, you can register for the 6 webinars at once. There are other smaller events planned for the second half of June and July, but more on that later because they are not finalized. There is no date fixed yet. And that was the content that I had. So unless there are other questions, any kind of questions, what I discussed today or Payara in general or Jakarta, microprofile. Maybe we can then close with the second poll.
Oh, yes, it's the second poll.
Almost.
I've just been putting the links in the chat. If anyone wanted to check out that Dismiss the Myths, there's the 6 states there.
Yes.
And you can register for one, or you can register for all, any combination of them as well. If you do miss one, we will be putting up these recordings on our YouTube. So keep an eye on that. I'll just put this poll up.
But we expect to have some discussion. So it is partially presentation, but most of the parts should also be discussion about what you think about Jakarta EE meets what we present. So question about the gRPC, do you have a use case for it? Or do you think that you have a use case? As I mentioned, there are some specific things, especially when you have a lot of data, streaming data, etc. No, I don't have that use case because I'm not deeply into microservices. So if you, then it's more, as I mentioned, between information flow. So that's more microservice related. Or yes, I like to explore the integration with other gRPC clients, because then again, you can have a client in any kind of language, Go, Python, whatever, JavaScript. I think there are also the gRPC clients. Or, as I mentioned, we would like to see it as a protocol for remote EGP calls, because that's not the case today, but that's one of the possible use cases that we were thinking of. So what do you think about gRPC?
Awesome. Well, we've got 85% now.
And I guess that would be it for it then. And the results are... And the winner is?
It's a bit of a landslide.
Okay, so most people are not that deeply into microservices, so they don't see the need for gRPC, which is fine, which is not a problem. It's not because it is there that you need to use it. And one person is indeed interested in seeing that as a remote EGP alternative. So that's something that indeed we need to keep in our heads when we plan this in the future, this the evolvement of this gRPC functionality. So unless there are no other questions,
Chris just adds that we missed the option of saying not yet.
Not yet. Okay, so then we have one person who is interested in using that gRPC as client. Okay, thank you for watching and for attending and for your questions. Hopefully it was useful. And as usual, if you have any questions, you probably know all the channels where you can reach us, Twitter, forum, and those kind of media.
Yes, for sure. Thank you very much, everyone. I'm going to put our meetup link in the chat. A lot of you would have come through there anyway, but just in case you do it, you want to, all of our sort of online events, even if it's not hosted directly through through our channels, we'll be doing through there, so you'll be able to catch Rudy all over the world. Brilliant. Thank you very much, guys. I will see you very soon. Bye.
Thank you. Bye.